Hello YouTube viewers, welcome to my channel Science to Technology. In today's show, Future Friday, we're gonna talk about antimatter. So let's dive right into it. Well, first we have to understand what the heck we are talking about. We are talking about a mirror image of our matter. So what does that mean? To understand that aspect, you have to go down. You basically have to go down to the core of matter. Matter is made out of atoms. Now, what happens if you go down inside that? Matter is basically made out of atoms. Atom is made out of subatomic particles. Now, this is a whole different category because this reaches what we classify as quantum level. At this point in time, normal classical rules does not. At this point, everything is just a vibration. So this standard model of elementary particles allows us to understand that behavior, core level, basically why neutron is a neutron, why proton is a proton. So we can understand those core behaviors on basis of these subatomic particles. Now at this point in time, you are reaching a world where if you have an antimatter, these things will change. Everything above that will remain exactly the same. It will not be like, okay, instead of having one proton, it has eight protons. It won't happen like that. But the core behavior will change because these sub-elementary particles will change. So what do I mean when they will change or they will become inverted or mirrored, whatever that means? It means charge will be inverted and their rotation. For example, you take electron, you will get positron, which is anti-electron. So charge would be, instead of positive, would be negative. Now you take proton, proton will go from positive to anti-proton. Now here's the interesting part, neutron, it does not have a charge, but it has a rotation. So it will go from clockwise to anti-clockwise. So that is the critical aspect here. Whatever we are trying to understand, it's on a very deep level, on a core level. Basically, you may think, okay, the electricity will not flow because, you know, its positron is on top and nothing. It will not make any difference because the changes are happening on a core, much core level. Basically, inherently, you changed everything without changing anything. So that's what we are talking about. Now, history of this is quite amazing simply because this was detected surprisingly early on in mathematics by Paul Dirac in 1928. So this puppy is old, as in like very old. The equation, again, I can't understand this equation. It's like on a god tier level. To give you an example of this man's genius, basically Paul Dirac, I would urge you to find a letter what Einstein wrote about him. Like Einstein could not understand this guy. He's on a different level. So he made the mathematical ideas like, dude, we're supposed to be invert of almost everything we have. Okay, that's an idea. How do we test it? Thankfully, by 1932, Carl David Anderson was doing experiments, what we call, on cloud chamber. Now, this is a cloud chamber. You can build cloud chamber in your home if you want to. And this allows us to see cosmic ray and particles and all that, just their interaction through a vapor trail, generally of alcohol or vapor trail. Now, he wanted to study those things. So he was doing that same research with a magnetic field. Now, he got a different photo. Now, why is this photo is so important? Because the path does not match a path of a proton, but the bend, basically how it's bending, it shows a path of a positive system. How the heck something that is not a proton can behave like a proton while having the mass of an electron? Because again, that's why the magnetic field was so important, because magnetic field directly interacts and reacts with positive particles and negative particles. So somehow something else was happening. And then he was like, oh, we found antimatter for first time in real life, in real photos. Okay, antimatter is here. So this was just an anti-electron, super easy to find. And then we went up to, by around 1950s, we had anti-protons and anti-neutrons. We got the whole atom there. So history is quite amazing. Like, we have laid down the foundation quite early on. Now, this is a very deep mystery. Basically, antimatter kind of explains some things and make other things super complicated, because you have to understand it. Universe came out of Big Bang. We know this. At this point in time, this is a known fact, not because we want to be like this. It's just like all our evidence point into that direction. So we got this. Okay, that came out. But how the heck you can have a universe out of zero? Short answer, you cannot. So antimatter solves that part of the equation, because if you go down to quantum level, everything is a vibration. So if vibration signal means you went up, that also means there was an equal and opposite digit in the other direction. So if you mix them up, you get zero. So universe can come out of zero, because it's basically vibration in zero. But here's the deal, somehow matter was created, antimatter was created, both of them merged and go to zero, but somehow there was an unbalance. Now that unbalance is our universe. Everything you see here around you, it's that imbalance. How the heck that imbalance happened? That is the core composition here. Now, Big Bang started from zero. This is a known part. But we still have matter because it's supposed to, you know, matter and antimatter should have collided and gone back to zero. That did not happen somehow. So this is the biggest question at this point in time. Like, if we can figure this puppy out, this is like on a whole different level. This makes a, like, you know, what happens at a black hole not that interesting, because this will explain how you can take a zero and make a universe out of that. So it's on a different level. This is a very important question. Why the heck there is matter, so to say. So matter antimatter imbalance is a very critical question, and antimatter is there, it's a real, we have tested it, we have made it, we have done experiments with it, it's as real as it can get, but somehow it's not there in the universe. So that is very very important questions, like why there is rather than nothing. So let's talk about the energy blur. I specified when you take both of them you got zero. So what does that mean? That simply means you are taking mass and making them into something else. But here's the deal, what are you doing with that? You have to understand E equal terms square. Now, E equal terms square in simplest term is simply the ratio between matter and energy. Matter and energy is exactly the same thing. The ratio is E equal terms square. So let's say you take uranium bomb and you went boom with that. So you got energy. Let's call that energy level X. So 1X you got out of uranium in fission. Now, what happens if you did with hydrogen? You went, let's do some extra boom with that. That is 7X, what we are talking about. Now, these events are very powerful events. These are like changing human civilization kind of thing and can destroy a planet kind of thing. So these are high energy events. At this point in time, our chemical energy is like, bro, we don't even come into the same scale. Like you do not have enough zeros to count these energy levels. So big puppies. So what is the efficiency we are talking about? They are working on E equal times square. So we are at the E mass to energy ratio. But what is the total efficiency? So if you take normal fission, you are talking about 0.1% efficiency, meaning you started with 1 kilogram, you converted the whole thing. How much matter turned into energy? That would be 0.1% in fission. And it would be 0.4% thereabout in hydrogen if you did fusion. So it's still not even 1%. Basically, E equal times square is there. It's like, bro, I'm here. Like, you can utilize me to, complete extent, but we can barely extract 1% of that. So it's not that oomphish. Even though in real life, like, they are very powerful. So we went from chemical to nuclear. Completely different ballgame. So same jump will happen if you go from nuclear to antimatter. Antimatter is like, bro, you don't even have enough zeros in you. Basically, 0.4. And antimatter is like 100%. Basically, it's as close to absolute as you're gonna get. It's 100%. So if you take antimatter, 100% of energy conversion will happen if you mix with equal matter. So what does that equal matter means? That means you take 1 gram of antimatter, you mix it with 1 gram of antimatter, and then you feed 2 gram into m part of the E equal to mc square, and then you get 100% energy. And energy would be in format of, rather than matter, basically rather than getting heavier ions or things of that nature, you're gonna get only photons, only smallest packet of energy that we know, photons. Lot of energy, lot of gamma rays, lot of oomph. So on an energy level, we are talking about something completely different. It's like another, it's like basically same way we went from chemical to nuclear. Nuclear is like antimatter. So this is what we are talking about. Energy is on a whole different level. Now let's understand its creation aspect. Now, one thing you have to understand, and I do blame all science fiction writers for this, is basically they show antimatter as an energy source. It's not energy source. We are making it. It's an energy carrier. For example, you take uranium out of the ground and you fuse it. Where are you getting that energy from? You're getting that energy from supernova. Supernova made that energy and you are extracting it now. Supernova, hypernova, things of that nature. So all the energies are coming from Big Bang. What about antimatter? Here's real antimatter. If existed in real life, it would have detonated itself the moment it touched any matter. So antimatter does not exist, like not in stable format. Maybe like it's created, but not in stable format. It's not like, okay, there is a wind coming out of sun, which is like antimatter. Maybe some places people are thinking about that black holes could have a jet eject out of them, which could be antimatter, but likelihood of that is very low. So reality is, it's what we classify as energy carrier. You have to make it yourself and then you can utilize it. So what it is at that point in time is basically the world's highest energy density feasible battery system, the most advanced, the most badass energy system that you are talking about we can build with this. So One another aspect is like, okay, that means we can build it. So what if we need to, afford something very small, very high density, and we can afford the bill for it? Can we do that with antimatter? Short answer, no. Why? Because at this moment in time, with Large Hadron Collider running, you would consume hundreds of megawatt or sometimes even more than that, and you're gonna get few watts of antimatter in terms of energy. Basically, particle accelerator is doing invert of equal to mc square. Basically, you're getting the mass out by putting energy in. We are not good enough with that technology. We cannot make it efficient enough, so to say. So flat out, it's not a doable thing. It would be like you consume whole planet's energy and you'll barely get enough energy to light up a small town, best case scenario, and that's also for a few hours. So reality is, it's not convertible. So we can make it in particle. Then what's the problem? If we can make it, what's the problem? Part is, you are trying to accelerate something as close to light speed as possible, which itself is very energy intensive, and the moment you collide it, the moment the big event happens, big energy event happens that creates antimatter, it's still at that high speed, the speed that you put into it. That's the problem. At that high speed, it's not stable. It's gonna react with something or collide with something else. So basically, accelerator makes it, but that very fact makes it very short-lived. So whatever people are doing in antimatter factories, they are taking a particle accelerator. It's like, okay, taking the beam, or some case they have their own generators, they're accelerating that puppy. They're going like, go YOLO on that. The moment they collide, it has the deal. They have a decelerator right after that. Collision happened, antimatter was created, and they decelerate that puppy as quickly as possible. That's the next step for us humanity. If we can decel that puppy right down, it's like instead of going 99.99% of speed of light to almost zero, boom, we have stable antimatter. At this point in time, we can slow it down. We have went from nothing to, okay, now we are counting antimatters every time we are turning on a particle accelerator, we are getting antimatter. So we went from maybe once a month to we turn it on, we get it. It's just we are trying to improve it. So that's the next evolution for us, making magnetic decelerators that can decel this puppy very quickly. So that's a very important aspect. Energy, it's not an energy source, it's an energy carrier. Now, what we can expect in the future? One thing you have to understand this very thoroughly. Now, I do not think this is a very good interstellar fuel, simply because you have to dump energy into it one way or the other. Might as well use that energy. So if you may be like, okay, what if I'm using solar collectors to dump this? You can make a powerful laser and push your craft using that. That would be much more simpler and much more efficient. So you can do that. And if you're using some magic fuel, let's say like helium-3, I'm saying magic because we do not know how to make the reactors. Basically, you did that. Just use that helium-3 goddamn on the ship. Yes, it will be bigger, it will be bulkier, but it still would be the same basically ballpark as a normal fusion system. So you can get much more stability out of that. So would we likely to see interstellar Star Trek system with basically flying antimatter reactors? Very unlikely, not impossible. But if you want to see how that could be possible, I would urge you to watch Isaac Arthur's video. I have provided the link down below. He went into awesome detail with that. So that's the future aspect. I do not think it's that much potential into that, but there is a lot of research potential, because it's a very critical mystery about our universe. Another aspect is, if this has some weird properties, because right now on paper we are assuming that if we drop, let's say we make a 1 gram of it, we drop it, it will drop. Gravity will react positively to it, basically the way it reacts to us. But what if it bounces up? We do not know. So there is a lot of research potential into this. Right now our theoretical model went from, we had a math, we figured it out, it's real, then we are trying to make it, but at this point in time we are barely making atoms of it. Before this, we were at the level where we are making basically subatomic particles, not whole atoms, but we are nowhere near where making whole basically block of aluminum, basically anti-aluminum block. We are not there yet, but if we reach that point, do we know how it's gonna behave, or will it have the properties that are completely different? Because at that point in time, let's say you start to make heavy elements out of that, let's say aluminum, iron, or things of that nature, and at that point in time it's stable enough that all you have to do is make, put it in the absolute vacuum and cool it down, which would be much easier than compared to anything else that we have right now, because antimatter, you cannot put most of them in one place because they will repel each other. So what can we do? Maybe that is the key to anti-gravity. Who knows? We do not know. That's why the research potential on those puppies are mind-bogglingly awesome. So a lot of research we have ahead of us. But what about real, close to Earth? Well, close to Earth, pet systems have already started to use some variant of this. This is a very complex technology, far beyond my understanding. So we do start to use this in PET scans. Now, PET scan is utilizing radiation to solve some problems. And end game is that they're gonna, right now, radiation therapy right now, it's like a machine gun at your body, but here's the deal, you only have one body and you are letting machine gun at it. So what engineers, doctors, and scientists want to do, instead of taking a machine gun, they want to make a sniper. They're like, I just want to take care of that tumor and just blow it up and don't have debris, you know, multiple bullet holes in your body. So that's what the end game is. And antimatter does have some potential that could allow us to do that safely. So there is a lot of potential medically also in this puppy. So future, in terms of research-wise, super bright. In terms of interstellar travel, unlikely. Medical, a lot of people are working on it right now. So this was my presentation on antimatters. I hope you liked it, enjoyed it, have fun with it. If you liked it, in that case, I will say, please click the like button, share it amongst your friends, that will help me a lot. If you didn't like it, didn't enjoy it, I urge you to press dislike, press it twice to show me extra disappointment. Please leave a comment because I try to reply to all of them. Subscribe, press the bell icon if you're free. And as always, thanks for watching.